So now is the time. We'll start. Good afternoon, everyone.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Borada Mahapatra, moderator of today's webinar. Already we have organized 20 webinars. So today we have the 21st webinar of ASB University, Bhubaneswar, Odisha. I request all the participants to mute their audio and video to avoid any technical glitches during the session. Thank you very much. Also, I request all the participants to write their questions in the chat box, and we will discuss all these questions in the question and answer session at the end. So today's topic is virtual learning, opportunities and challenges. As you know that due to COVID-19 and series of lockdown and shutdown, the educational organizations started taking classes and academic activities through online mode as the last resort. We have absorbed many opportunities, and also we cannot deny to the challenges that we have faced. So I'll not take much of the time as we have experts to speak on this topic. So now we are fortunate enough to have with us Professor Pramod Pathak from IIT Dhanbad. Professor Pathak is senior professor of management at one of the oldest premier higher education institute of India, ISM Dhanbad, is now IIT, has been a student of psychology for the last over 45 years, teaching, researching and consulting on a wide range of subjects, holding a PhD in stress management, is a postgraduate in psychology and an MBA from BHU, India. A social scientist of considerable experience, Dr. Pathak is a reputed commentator, blogger, and widely read columnist on contemporary global issues for over two decades. I welcome you, sir, to ASB University and to this webinar. Thank you very much, sir, for accepting our invitation and giving the opportunity to listen to you.
Thank you.
Also, we have we are fortunate to have with us Professor Nandita Roy from IIM Lucknow. Professor Roy is an assistant professor of communication at IIM Lucknow. Prior to her appointment at IIM Lucknow, she taught business communication at IIM Kashipur from 2016 to 2018. She was also a great lecturer in a guest lecturer in communicative English at National University of Judicial Sciences, Kolkata. Her industry experience includes working as media consultant for National Geographical Channel India. Her doctoral thesis in narrativity and storytelling in video games. Her research interests include game-based learning, social media communication, business narratives, and gender studies. I welcome you, ma'am, to ASB University and to this webinar. Thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you so much.
Now I would like to request Professor Pramod Pathak to address this virtual gathering. Please, sir.
Thank you, Professor Mahapatra. I'd like to make a couple of amendments to what Professor Mahapatra told about me. But before that, I would like to greet all of you, including Nandita Roy. Good afternoon, and I think welcome to this webinar. Now, coming to what Professor Mahapatra told about me, I must admit that in my 45 years of studies, teaching and research, and another say 15, 17 years in school and all, I never came across such a situation. So I don't claim to be an expert on anything like this, but yes, this, as Professor Mahapatra very rightly said, is as a last resort. We didn't have any options. So when you don't have options, you do whatever is possible. So that is how this virtual learning came to be a part of our routine teaching. Virtual learning was already there, but it was only as a means of supplement. But suddenly, the tiniest of the particles, it forced the entire humanity to take a recourse to virtual learning. So that is how the online platform became the mode of teaching. The subject which Professor Mahapatra has chosen is rather interesting: virtual learning opportunities and challenges. In simplest of the terms, it is opportunities for the online platform providers and challenges for the rest of the stakeholders. That is a fact. So in fact, you know, just one example, that Zoom, you know, had 10 million users in March, and now there are over 200 million. So, and then a host of other platforms have come up. I mean, see, everyone wants to make hay while the sun shines, or the corona shines, whatever. So that is how it is. But that, of course, was in lighter vein, although it makes a lot of sense. But that apart, virtual learning has come up as a means to keep education going. It was being used for quite some time. We had video conferencing, IGNU and other universities, they tried that. We had e-content teaching sites and things like that. HRD ministry had also organized, but that was just to support the existing teaching and to reach to those people who did not have the opportunity of attending physical classes. But what has now happened is that we don't have any other option. So the online teaching and learning, instead of supplementing, has become a substitute. Right or wrong is a debatable issue, but since there were no options, this was the only recourse left to all of us. So it was this online learning and teaching, or virtual learning as we call, that kept at least education going. Otherwise, the educational institutions would have been closed. So that was one reason why we had to take a recourse to this what we call mode of teaching. One thing, however, we have realized now, although there were so many people talking about virtual learning, interactive medium and things like that, we have now realized one very important thing, that virtual learning is no substitute, or a very poor substitute, for physical classroom learning. That has been proved beyond doubt. So that, of course, I think will again make us believe what we think is right. And maybe in future, because this thing is not going to last forever. So in future, we'll now realize that how important physical interactive teaching in the classrooms were. And then it also proved one more thing, that man, after all, is a gregarious animal, no matter how much of social media he or she uses. So these two things have been proved beyond doubt. Now coming to challenges. The important thing to note here is that there are challenges and challenges, because on both the sides, the teacher side also, because we are all learning, we didn't have an experience like this, and we are still learning, and of course struggling. And the same applies to the other side of the fence, the student side. They also never had such an experience. So they are also learning. And in fact, both these sides are learning through trial and error, making efforts, and coming to conclusions which they did not have earlier. But there are some very major issues. And this, of course, is not an issue only in a country, developing country like ours. It is even in developed countries like United States of America. Professors from Harvard also are wondering about the problems faced in online teaching. And there's one more thing. They are much more sophisticated, much more advanced, and still they are thinking of the problems. In fact, I was attending one webinar from one Harvard professor and lady professor from France, and they were discussing, and that lady said that she has a real studio through which she is teaching, and there are 5 cameras from 5 sides, and all she has to do is to press buttons. Still she is wary of the online mode of teaching. We of course have no such avenues available. So we are just, you know, a poor country cousin of those universities still, but we don't have any other options. So the basic challenges I have, in fact, because I have also, there's no research as such, I learned through observation, through experience, and experience of course is a very costly teacher. So I learned after a lot of trouble that there are 5 major issues related to technology first. I call them the 5 C's, C for Calcutta, 5 C's of, excuse me, this telephone, 5 C's of technology related issues. The first one is, and this is particularly true about developing countries. First is connection. And before that, I'd like to add one more thing, that we have terribly mixed up online teaching and online learning. They are entirely different things, or rather online classes and online learning. So online classes, when we talk about that, we start with an assumption that everybody has equal access and equal quality of connectivity at his place, which is not a case, which is not a case. So first challenge is what we call connection. Everyone having a smartphone of the same quality, everyone having an internet connection at his place, everyone is able to support, or what we call afford, because many parents had to sell land to enable their children to go for online classes. So things like that are happening in the rural areas. But that apart, so connection is one issue, that the assumption that everyone has same level of connection is erroneous. So that is the first C. The second C is the connectivity. So connection is one. Even if you have a smartphone, connectivity is another issue. In fact, I was the other day attending a webinar organized by All India Management Association, and one of the illustrious speakers was Dr. Shashi Tharoor. And the first thing he said was that I have a terrible internet connection in Kerala today. That is how he started. So connectivity is again another issue. I guess I'm audible to all of you, na? Okay. So because I cannot speak louder than this. So connectivity is the second challenge and a major one. I'm still wary whether this internet connection will last the entire 1 hour or not. So it gives a lot of stress and anxiety and fear. So because I'm talking about these 3 things, because subsequently what I'll talk about will be related to that. Then the third challenge is the competence. See, we have often been fooled or duped by the computer manufacturers that there are user-friendly computers. I beg to differ. There are only computer-friendly users. So that is a major difficulty. For instance, I have to rely on my young colleagues. In fact, at times, my grandson, who is 7 years old. So that reverse mentoring is how I am learning. Because I am not conversant enough. And at this age, I don't think I should try to do that, because that will be giving me in economics, we talk about comparative advantage. So why should I waste my time learning this? And of course, even if I try, an old dog, cannot learn new tricks. So that is there. So competence is another issue. I mean, there are participants and participants, teachers and teachers. Every person has different levels of competence as far as using the online platform or the computer is concerned. So that is the third issue. The fourth issue is concern. Now, given the first three things, even if I am concerned, I will not be able to prove it. And technology will not believe it. So the assumption on the part of the organizations will be that I am not concerned. But despite my best efforts, I have my limitations. And they will always be there. So that concern is the fourth challenge, the fourth C. And finally, the culpability. That means if it flounders, who is responsible? Naturally, the what we call easiest person to flog is the teacher. So the teacher is hauled up. So these five C's are major challenges. And I think we are persisting with this and will not be able to go to the level of perfection which can make these online classes a useful substitute for physical interaction that happens in the classroom. That is the first part. Now, this is just one part. There is another second part and equally important. That is, of course, Nandita will also support me. That is related to communication. Now, in the classroom, when we communicate, when we interact, it is, you know, some kind of a two-way interaction. And there are many ways in which we make things amply clear, which words cannot suffice. So now, in order to be effective communicators in the classroom, we need to communicate at four levels. The first level is the visual level. So when we are talking in the classroom, when we are lecturing in the classroom, we are communicating at the visual level to all our students, in turns, of course. So eye-to-eye contact, which is so vital for effective learning. It is so vital. But this online platform doesn't give me that opportunity. And there's another interesting fact. I have no mechanism to find out whether every student is equally attentive or not, or he has switched off his video and sleeping. So there's no means. And again, there's another issue. We try to take tests also, quizzes also. There also, it is not a foolproof mechanism because they will mute their mics and shut their videos and discuss amongst themselves. And they are doing it actually. So this visual level communication, that we are missing, and it is very important. The second level at which we communicate in the classroom is the physical level. Physical level means gesticulating, the body language. In fact, there are researches to suggest that most of the effectiveness of communication comes from body language, non-verbal part. So that non-verbal part is missing in this, what we call, online teaching. So physical level is also missing. My gestures, my body language, my actions, they're not there. The third level is the emotional level. To some extent, we are able to do that by, say, changing the pitch of our voice, raising it, lowering it down. Like, say, sometimes, you know, if you want to understand this, the best way is to understand how an actor delivers his dialogue, Amitabh Bachchan. So he raises his voice and lowers it down from a shrill, you know, comment to a whisper. That is how he makes the communication effective. In the classrooms also, we do this. So that is why, you know, there is a great difference between Amitabh Bachchan, Shah Rukh Khan, Dilip Kumar on the one side, and Salman Khan and the ilk on the other side, even though Salman's films are bigger hits, that does not make his communication as effective as Amitabh Bachchan's. So in films, of course, it is the box office yield that matters, but in classroom, it is the learning that matters. So for this learning, what we need is that communicating at the emotional level also, changing the pitch of the voice, the vibrations, the whispers, the loud sound of your vowels, emphasis, things like that. So that is missing. And the fourth level at which we need to communicate is the intellectual level. So it is only that level which is to maximum extent possible in the online classrooms and online teaching. So of course, but that doesn't mean that we'll have to stop all this, because there's no other way out. So what do we need to do? We need to learn one thing, that try to make this as interactive as possible. In fact, I do that. I keep on prompting my students that please unmute your mic. Can you follow me? It's like, I tell them that you first go and read the Arabian Nights. So that lady said the king that you'll have to prompt every time I end a story. So the same thing should be here, that you'll have to prompt so that I know whether you are listening or sleeping. So that has to be practiced. And so there'll be frequent interruptions like that. And not interruptions exactly, in the classroom also it happens. So that is needed. So you have to make more and more interactive in whatever form you can, number one. And number two, you have to engage them. So naturally, of course, Nanita is a storyteller. In fact, I'm also a storyteller. So storytelling is a very useful way in which you can engage the classrooms in online platforms. But the important thing which I wanted to mention here is that you will have to not only emphasize engagement in the online teaching, you'll have to facilitate online learning materials. You have to ensure supply of online learning materials in plenty. And you have to encourage these students to learn more. Self-study is very important. So right from what we call pedagogy to andragogy to now heutagogy, self-learning is rather the important thing. And we, of course, have these models in our past, scriptures. Like in Mahabharata, we have both the models. One was the teacher-centric model through which Arjun learned archery. Dronacharya taught him. The other was the learner-centric model, which Eklavya followed. And Eklavya just, built a statue of Dronacharya and learned through self-learning. So in online teaching and learning, the self-learning has to be emphasized also, because only engaging classrooms through online platforms may not help in the level of learning that is required to make them learn what the teacher wants them to learn. So the important thing is to evolve this methodology, as long as we have to persist with this. I'm very sure that it's not going to last long. We are, of course, according to me, we are in the last leg, that I'm amply sure. And maybe in a couple of months or so, it should go away and we'll be back in the classrooms in the same vibrant mode in which we used to teach. But till then, of course, is the only option. So we can make best possible use of whatever we can do in this online teaching. So I think that was the time allotted to me, 15, 20 minutes. So, Professor Mahapatra, thank you very much. And thank you all. Thank you.
Sir, it's true that we are missing the levels, as you mentioned, sir. That is physical level, emotional level, intellectual level. Thank you very much, sir, for your valuable insights of this topic. So now I would like to request Professor Nandita Roy to address this virtual gathering. Please, ma'am.
Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. And thank you, Professor Mahapatra, for inviting me and giving the opportunity to talk in such an interesting about such an interesting thing. And I'd also like to thank Professor Patrick. It was absolutely mesmerizing to listen to you. And you could see me nodding all the time because I agree with almost everything that Professor Patrick said. Because when you introduce us as experts, I think all of us right now are kind of in the same boat. And what happens in this, like, I taught my first online courses from July to September. Now, a couple of things happened. The first one was, because we are all in the same boat, I think a faculty at Harvard is actually figuring out almost as much, and trying to figure out as much as a faculty at maybe an IIM. There are obvious disparities, and I'm coming to that. But this particular juncture of technology, of teaching, I think also presents certain opportunities. We have all heard about the challenges, and Professor Pathak has beautifully encapsulated all the different facets of the challenges. So I'm going to share my experience, and I'm going to try and think of some of the opportunities that we might glean from this situation. And Professor Pathak, I sincerely hope that we are in the last leg of this struggle. Couple of things. The first concern that I had, because I am a teacher of communication, I go to my class and, body language is considered to be around 55%, if you can quantify something like that, of communication. So how I'm standing in class, how I'm looking at a student, I'm expressing so many things. You know, I'm happy with your answer. I'm not really happy with your answer. I can see that your eyes are going somewhere. You're looking at the phone. All of that is missed when you are teaching online, which is why at IIM Lucknow, when I teach, I ask every single participant, every single student in my class to keep their videos on. That at least gives me a semblance of interactivity, that I can see their faces, I can see their expressions. But that's always not possible because of the disparity that Professor Pathak mentioned in internet connectivity, in access to technology. How many people have access to smartphones with good cameras? In a classroom somehow, students can appear equal to us. But in the online scenario, someone is logging in from a 1080p camera or an iPad Pro, and someone is logging in from a 360p camera, the disparity becomes quite pronounced. Second is constantly, before I started teaching, I was thinking of online teaching as a barrier. But then I started thinking that, if this medium, if this technology was not there, there was no way in which we could start classes. So I tried to orient, and this is perhaps, I think, this has been one thing I learned during the pandemic, not just regarding online teaching, but about surviving in general, is to reorient the way I see things a little bit. So from thinking about online teaching as a barrier, I tried to look at it from the other side, think of it as a bridge. That if this was not there, yeah, there are so many difficulties with this. But if this was not there, how would I be able to teach at all? So, and once I changed my way of seeing, my perception, I started to also enjoy online teaching. And I'll talk about how, I'll tell you how I did that. So first, I think one very important learning for me was to reorient our own thought process in the way to see it not as a barrier, not solely as a barrier, but also as a bridge. I could interact with my students. At least I could see their faces. At least I could talk to them. at least I could share whatever I had to teach. So that was crucial for me. Second thing, which I find it very, very important during this time, is, like Professor Pathak said, self-learning. Now, that also puts immense pressure on students in the sense that how much am I going to learn or how am I going to learn? But any student who is listening in right now, just think of it. Think of all the extra time perhaps which you have right now. All the books which you thought that, yeah, I will read someday. This is the time to just sit back, get to the book and start reading. Again, see this time as an opportunity. I was quite behind on my readings. Because I'm so busy, because I had to travel such a lot. After March, many of my travel engagements were cancelled. What did I do? I caught up on my reading. I started reading all those books which I did not, you know, I would buy it and put it here right on my shelf, thinking that, okay, I don't have time right now. I'll get to it later. So this gave me a time to get to it. So self-learning and self-development right now, like Professor Pathak has mentioned, is a very, very crucial way of upskilling yourself. You upskill yourself during this time. These are difficult times. And if you find yourself being slightly less productive than you used to be earlier, please don't give yourself a hard time, because we are going through a global pandemic. In terms of my own learning in terms of teaching, three or four things I'm going to discuss. The first one, especially for teachers who are teaching classes where students have difficulty in accessing technology. I have had this discussion with many of my own professors, my friends and colleagues at Jadavpur University. And as you know, in Jadavpur University, many of the students, they come from quite remote parts of the country. They don't have access to a smartphone. They can't attend or can't join the class live. So what many of us advised was to go for a hybrid form of online teaching. What is the hybrid form? The teacher can record their lecture. Okay, I can talk for 15 minutes or 20 minutes. I can record that lecture. And I can have two formats, both audio and video. Now, as you know, audio formats are much more easier to send. Even someone with a more or less basic phone will be able to download that audio and listen to it. And then you send that out to your students. And maybe 20 minutes time or whatever, 15 minutes, you can ask them to, you know, send you their queries. In fact, a lot of my friends at universities in the US are using this hybrid method, because teaching online is very stressful for teachers also, because A, you don't have that classroom spontaneity and the interactivity, and secondly, because let's say it's a 1.5 hour lecture, the teacher, and I also realized this, and all of my colleagues said the same thing, the teacher has to speak for a longer time. In classroom, it's more interactive. We ask questions. The students ask questions. So in many US universities, what they're doing is they are playing a recorded lecture. If it's a 90-minute session, the recorded lecture is played for 1 hour or something, and then the teacher is doing a live interaction. So that's one way of approaching, especially for teachers or students who are who do not have much access. Secondly, is which I did for my courses, was to, I realized, you know, before I started teaching, I taught storytelling. And I do tell a lot of stories in class. The first thing I realized was that I cannot keep the same material which I taught last year. Because now the situation has changed. the mode of delivery has changed. So my pedagogy also needs to evolve, also needs to change. If not evolve is a stronger word, it needs to reorient itself. So reorienting our courses, and redesigning our learning. How did I redesign? You can introduce some elements, like in my course, I introduce some new elements in assessment. Earlier, I would just give case studies and they would sit and write the exam. Now, because I had the online, I thought, okay, again, thinking in terms of, you know, not a barrier, but a bridge. I said, how can online teaching or online mode help me in making better assessments in communication? So one thing I introduced was, I asked one question to students. I said, this was in my communication course. I said that, what do you think is effective communication? And very simple question. Normal times, they would write the answer on pen and paper. I told them that, why don't you record a 2-minute video and send it to me? So that way, I could see the body language, I could see the pitch, and I could hear the pitch and the tone and the way they approach a question, how many times they're stopping and thinking like this. So that, I for me, it was quite interesting, because although I taught 160 students, all of them sent these 2-minute videos. So according to what you are teaching or what you are learning, one way to make the most of this time, of this bizarre pandemic ridden world, is to reorient what you are doing a little bit of thinking. And sometimes you might, like for me, it gave me a unique way of evaluating my students. Course structures also. The kind of texts that I would prescribe usually, I changed the course material. I put in more case studies. And I insisted that, you know, in the chat box, the students would have to, I would ask a question and the students would have to write 1, 2, 3, 4 like that. And one would be, because one problem in online teaching, one of the biggest challenges which I found out was, like in a class, you can see it's a wide field of view. You can see everybody. And one person raises their hand and you say, okay, so there is no cross talking. But online, you know, when 5 people want to talk at the same time, it becomes a mess, right? And mic muting, unmuting, it's just too much. So I said that in the chat box, I'll ask you a question. In the chat box, just put 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 like that. And I'm going to call one by one, you know, whoever answers. In order to make, and you know what, other subjects I think might be possible, but in the subjects I teach, communication, storytelling, it's impossible to teach without interacting. What will I keep? It's not as if, you know, it's not a one-way process. It's a two-way process. It's teaching, learning. I'm also learning. The students are teaching me. So it's not a one-way thing. And therefore, I sort of increased the number of group activities. There is something called Jamboard in Google, Google Classroom, Google Meet itself. You can have access to the Jamboard. And there the students can write and interact with each other and the teacher can also see. So using these things. And third thing which I found very crucial, right now for both the student and the teacher community, it's very important for everyone to come together and share their learnings. What we did in our institute was, just before every term the courses would start, all of us, all like 40, 50 of us who would teach, we sort of did many meetings on Google Meet. And some, you know, every time some professor or the other, someone who has taught 2 classes comes and say, hey, don't do that. That actually backfired. Let's try this. And a lot of innovation came in. I shared my learnings with my colleagues. Others shared with me. My students many a time told me, because sometimes, you know, we are not abreast with the latest technology, but the kids are. They came and said, ma'am, you know, in the Jamboard, do it this way. So I think we as teachers have to be open, and as students, any student listening in, if you see one of your professors or anyone who's teaching and might be struggling with, you know, sharing the PowerPoint or any kind of struggle, if you can, if you know how to do that, if you can help out, please take the initiative to do so. And that, I believe, adds an element of interactivity that helps us grow, it helps us learn. It helps us exchange knowledge. It's very important. Couple of things. Another, the last thing that I will talk about in terms of, you know, thinking it as a bridge, not a barrier, is I tried this, and it's sort of, I think, for my students, it was better. I did not let my course, because I did not have all the privileges of an offline classroom teaching experience, I did not let my course end after the 1.5 hours. So I set up a separate Google Classroom. Many colleagues have been setting up WhatsApp groups and encouraging students that even outside the class, outside the 1.5 hour lecture, think about it, think about questions, keep them engaged. Sometimes, you know, I would share an interesting, when I taught, let's say in storytelling, I teach messaging. And I taught messaging, I did everything. In the evening, I go back home and I put a video, an advertisement on Google Classroom. And I ask the students, you know, what do you think about this ad? How does it employ persuasive techniques? Not all, obviously, out of 160 students, maybe 20 or 30 would, you know, watch that ad. Now they are also sitting at home, they are, you know, so if you can do some something which will keep them thinking about the course even after the class, that helped me. Many of my students came and told me that it also helped them learn. It helped them engage a little more with the course. That was interesting for them. So I think in terms of the challenges, all of us understand the challenges. We are living, I think, in unprecedented, difficult times. But the only way that we can get through this, and I really hope if you ask any teacher at any level of teaching anywhere in the world, and you ask them, then what would you prefer, online teaching or offline teaching? I think they will say classroom teaching, hands down. But for me, of course, I would also prefer that. But for me, it helped me to become a better teacher, perhaps. It helped me to analyze my own weaknesses. It helped me to look at myself, you know, when I'm delivering and find out certain flaws in my delivery. I can do this better, right? Because recorded sessions, I never had access to my own recorded sessions. So self-learning, both in terms of students and teachers, is a huge thing. So this was very helpful for me. Second, I kept thinking that this is, let's not get into a mode where I'm constantly thinking, oh, it's a barrier. How will I teach in technology and this and that? Let me think of it as a bridge. Let me reorient my course. Let me reorient my tests, my assessments. Let me make it more interesting for students, you know. Let me also engage them outside the 1.5 hours in the class. These four or five things helped me get through it. And as I speak, you know, next week I'm going to start again. And that's going to be, again, I have almost no clue because I'm going to teach writing. So teaching writing online is because in the class, what I do is I give them the assignments and I go around the class looking at their copies and make corrections and say, hey, this is not really teached kind of thing. So that needs to be, I'll miss that, but I have to find out a way of teaching writing in an interesting way. Maybe I will reorient the assignments. I'll have to sit and think about it. So this time, in terms of opportunities, the biggest opportunity is to become more creative. And like, you know, there's this famous comic called Comic or Philosophy. It's Calvin and Hobbes. And there this little boy, Calvin, once says that there is nothing in the world which fuels creativity as much as, you know, panic and crisis. Necessity being the mother of invention, basically. So I think this is a time of necessity where we have to dive in into online learning, online teaching. And this is the time when we can innovate. Perhaps some of the changes that we make to our own selves, our ways of learning, our ways of teaching, our courses, our assessments, maybe some of those we can take back to classroom teaching to make classroom teaching better. So I think that's about the time I had. I'll request Professor Mahapatra to, if there are any questions, I'd love to address. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for your impressive presentation. Now we will quickly go to the question and answer session. Ma'am, there is a question from you asked by Mr. Sudhanshu Panda. What is the scope of virtual learning in our new education policy 2020?
I was on mute, sorry. The new education policy, I'm afraid, I have only made a cursory reading of it. And does it incorporate, I'm not familiar because when it was drafted, when also a lot of professors, we suggested a lot of changes into it, that was in pre-COVID times. So there was, I don't know if any, when it was being drafted, when it was being edited, COVID was nowhere in the horizon. So I don't think there are anticipated changes or anticipated special sections about online learning there. But I think if you talk about the way governments or public policy can help, online learning does have a lot of opportunity, especially if the government makes a basic effort to ensure connectivity. Now, in our country, many places don't have electricity. I am sitting in Lucknow, and even being in my privileged position, I suffer from power cuts. I am constantly panicking while I am in the webinar, you know, when the power might go, when Wi-Fi might go. So the first thing, you know, I think for the government to think is basic infrastructure. If we can provide that to our people, perhaps, you know, it will help in.
Okay, ma'am, another question also from, it's Mr. Biswajit Swain.
Right.
Ma'am, he's asking, should we expect that in future, this virtual learning would be the new normal?
Here, I would like to refer back to what Professor Pathak had said. I sincerely hope, like sir said, that we are in the last leg of this crisis. But at the same time, online learning is already it's a good way of learning for people who are not always, you know, geographically possible to go from one place to the other. For example, Harvard or MIT, for example, they have a lot of MOOCs, massively open online courses. The whole material is online. You listen to recorded lectures and you learn. So online learning is not new. It has been very much there. 1995, I think, MIT started their first MOOC. So this has been very much there. In fact, a lot of courses which IIMs and IITs do, executive education, MBPs, online management development programs, they are there. What I think in future, one thing is going to help that right now, because, you know, earlier many of us would say, no, I'm not going to teach an online MBP, right? But now, because all of us have been sort of pushed into the pool and made to swim, we have learned to swim, we have learned to teach online, I think that experience will help us to make online teaching more accessible, to make online courses more engaging, more interesting, even when the necessity of, you know, online classes go away. So yes, definitely it is a skill which might help all of us in the future. I think yes, it will stay for some.
Okay. I want Professor Pathak to take this question. The question is from Dr. Biranji Prasad Mishra. He's asking, can you suggest effective method of delivery when the levels of students is very low, with 80 to 90% of the class strength and not interested in study in professional binding as they join for a degree and we are teachers?
I'd like you to repeat the question, please.
He's asking, sir, can you suggest effective method of delivery when the levels of students is very low, with 80 to 90% of the class strength and not interested in study in professional binding as they join for a degree and we are the teachers?
Of course, this is based on a certain assumption. So, and a hypothetical question. But nevertheless, see, teaching is a job where these kinds of situations will arise, and these things I rate as professional hazard. So in that situation, the teacher has to raise his level of teaching to ensure that the lectures or the learning which he is providing is at this level of the, is at the same wavelength as that of the student. So creating interest in the classroom is what a teacher has to do. And in fact, there are very interesting movies that can suggest what to do. Like there was a film in English, Hollywood, Sound of Music, and in Hindi, Parichay. So these films were based on this very assumption.
Sir, another question also, we can address this question. How to design a blended approach of teaching in online? Synchronous or asynchronous methods?
See, designing online teaching material, as I said in the very beginning, is that you'll have to back up your online classes with online learning resources. And as Nandita said, you have to, you know, follow the hybrid model. You'll have to not only use your own videos, you can use videos from film clippings also. And they will in fact attract even the most lethargic of the students. So there is no harm in using film clippings. In fact, as far as I am concerned, these Bollywood films, they do a lot of research, much more valid research than what the universities are doing. In fact, a film of 1930 is valid today. If you read, and then that applies to Hollywood also. If you see Charlie Chaplin's Modern Times, it appears as if it is happening in 2020.
Okay, thank you, sir. So there is another question from Mr. Jitendra Pal Singh. Sir, I'm not getting exactly the question. You have written, during the online session interaction is not properly executed to clear the doubts, or else sending the message and expecting the reply. So can you please tell me what is the question, sir? Jitendra, sir. Hello, Jitendra sir, can you hear us?
Yes sir.
Sir, please ask the question. Ask the question.
Hello.
During the online session, interaction is not properly executed to clear the doubts. All is sending the message and
it's not properly.
Exactly what is the question, sir?
As well as also, there are so many things now. They are not properly see the sessions, your construction, construction approach, and these that. And moreover, they can't attend all the queries, all the doubts to all of the students now.
Okay, sir, you understood the question? Okay, actually, some unpleasant sound. We cannot hear you, sir. Actually, can you repeat again, sir? Jitendra, sir, can you repeat the question again?
Sir, I just mean that during the webinar, interaction is important. But when it is not properly executed, is it able to clear the doubts of all the students?
Okay, I can.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Not clear.
Yes, ma'am.
I think because so many mics are on, the feedback, it becomes a lot of feedback is there. So I think even in a classroom situation, you will see that if it's a classroom of 60 people, not all students will ask questions. Some are shy, they will not ask or something like that. But in the classroom, as teachers, I think we always try to answer or address as many queries as possible. Personally speaking, when it comes to online teaching also, I try to wrap up my material by, I teach 1.5 hour class. I keep 15 to 20 minutes in the end solely for queries and questions of the students. And even outside that, you know, like I said, teaching or learning does not end with the class time, right? Every day, you know, sometimes 1 month or 2 months after the course has finished, a student will write a mail and ask me that, you know, ma'am, you said something that time which is not clear. So we continue to interact. And I think as teachers, as students, I always say you must ask as many questions as you can. No question is stupid. No question is that will I sound very unintelligent if I ask this? No. The most intelligent thing to do is to ask any questions that you have, right? So for both students, keep asking, and for teachers, keep answering those questions. Take your time. Answer through emails, phone calls, upon your availability.
Okay, so another question, we will take one or two questions. Another question from Mr. Sangram Panda. He's asking, can virtual learning help to increase the cognitive level of students compared to previous situations before pandemic?
What's that? Please.
Can virtual learning help to increase the cognitive level of the students compared to previous situation before pandemic?
Yes, it can. There's no reason why it should not. The only thing is that the effort should be more from both the sides. That's all. It certainly can. As I said, that is why I gave you the model of Ekalavya. He was a better archer than Arjun, but for that giving the thumb. It certainly can work.
Okay, this is the last question, sir, from Swastik Raut. How virtual reality can be integrated with online learning educational platforms to improve the educational output?
I am not getting the question. How virtual reality?
How virtual reality can be integrated with online learning educational platforms to improve the educational output?
That is what is. I mean, it says. See, instead of what we are doing now is. Because we don't have any other option, so we are only relying on the virtual learning. But this is not going to last till eternity. It's coming to an end. And so virtual learning will be supplementing the physical learning. and it has been happening.
Okay, thank you, sir. Sir, ma'am, I request you to take this last question. Mr. Sangram Panda is asking, is there any change found between the relation between the students and teachers during post-COVID?
I can only speak because there's no research being done on this. I can speak from my personal experience and what I've been hearing. In my interactions, I think it's very strange, but I found in this term students being more interactive. You know why? Because they were sitting in their own comfort when they first year students, when they come into a IIM and they have to sit in those big classrooms, they have a lot more hesitation, I felt. Now, sitting in their own comfortable spaces, I think that hesitation had reduced quite a lot. And many of them approached me, started asking me, ma'am, what do you, can you suggest books to read? What should we do, etc. And I think that the pandemic has made us realize how precious those social situations or those interactions which we would take for granted really are. So right now, any kind of human contact that we experience, even though it's online, we try to treasure it more, I think. So yeah, yes and no, there has been both kinds of things. Some students who would interact more perhaps have stopped interacting, so that's also happened. So you see that definitely changes in social relations, changes not just in student-teacher relations, in friendships, in colleagues, in kind of professional relationships, it's all happened, yes, definitely post-COVID and pre-COVID. I hope and I'm sure someone will do research on it soon.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. So now coming to the end part of the webinar, I must convey my thanks to our panel members, Professor Patel and Professor Roy, for this and speak as a topic. Thank you very much, ma'am, for accepting our invitation to grace this occasion. I must convey my thanks to our president and founder, Professor Biswajit Patnaik, our Vice Chancellor, Professor Kalyan Sankal Ray, and our Pro-Vice Chancellor, Professor Falgu Niranjana, for their support and standing behind us to make a program success. I convey my thanks to our Dean School of Accountancy, Professor Hemant Panda, for his support, and also special thanks to the webinar team for making this possible. Last but not the least, I convey my thanks to all the participants from India and also from other countries for their copious and patient hearing. Also, I found Mr. Jos Vargas from Mexico. He joined for this webinar. Thank you very much, sir. And have a good day to all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, everybody. It was nice meeting you.